I think we should make a start. So welcome to the second in a series of four lectures revolving around the topic of ornament. The AA tonight welcomes Isabelle Frank, currently the Associate Dean for Academic Affairs at the New School in New York. I became aware of Isabelle Frank's work when I first started researching the topic of ornament. I soon stumbled upon a fantastic reader, a compilation of theoretical texts on the decorative arts and ornament that would never be far from my sight for years to come. And I left it on my chair. So, The Theory of Decorative Art, an Anthology of European and American Writings from 1750 to 1940, edited by Isabelle Frank and published by Yale University Press in 2000, is a veritable treasure trove of the great and the good. It manages to brilliantly contrast chosen sections of seminal essays by John Ruskin or Gottfried Semper with lesser-known extracts from texts by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe or Le Corbusier. Its back cover claims that by recovering theoretical debates about decorative art, this book helps to dispel the confusion surrounding this artistic category, and that this well-conceived volume should make it a standard reference work for many decades. And indeed, it has become exactly that. Without this book, and without Isabelle Frank's insightful and precise introductions to each chapter, my students and my own journey into the labyrinthine universe of ornament would have been all but aimless shots in the dark. So who better to shine a light ahead as we re-enter this lost discourse, as we are trying to find a new language to describe the contemporary incarnations of ornamental practice, a language that befits its history as well as its future. Isabelle Frank received her BA in art history from Princeton and her PhD from Harvard, specializing in Italian Renaissance art. After teaching for several years at the Bard Graduate Center for Studies in the Decorative Arts, she became program director of fellowships at the American Council of Learned Societies. She then was associate director of academic programs at Northwestern University before joining the New School. Apart from the theory of decorative arts, she has also published Die Rhetorik des Ornaments in 2001, alas, one for us German speakers only, it seems. Without further ado, and after having seen the title of the lecture with much excitement and a little fear and trepidation, please join me in giving a warm welcome to our guest tonight, Isabelle Frank.
Well, thank you. And I was telling Oliver that I've never seen so many interested people in ornament. When my book came out 8 years ago, got a few reviews, and then I sort of didn't hear anything about it. So it was with great excitement that I realized that actually there was a whole room full of people who wanted to hear about ornament. So without further ado, I will start on my talk. And I assume that you've chosen this topic today because of the difficulty of discussing what architectural ornament is, or is not, should, or could be. As Kent Bloomer, who spoke in this series last month, notes in his The Nature of Ornament, quote, "Brief discussions of ornament are often tainted by contemporary uses of the term itself. Ornament comes loaded with conflicted and even negative meanings." And in his book, Bloomer still feels he has to defend ornament against a slew of charges, but charges that are now more than a century old. And yet, of course, ornament is ever present in contemporary practice. It is visible in the self-consciously postmodernism use of ornamental motifs, such as in Philip Johnson's Sony building, which when it was built was called the Chippendale building because of its clear reference with that one huge motif on top. Or it still lives in Norman Foster's architecture. Here you see his extension renovation to the Dolder Grand Hotel, where he uses the shades to create a rich patterned surface, as well as with his balconies on the outside of that same building. And of course, Frank Gehry prides himself on fashioning entire sculptural forms, as in the Guggenheim Museum at Bilbao, an ornament in and of itself. There seems to be a disjuncture between contemporary architectural practice of ornament and its theory. There are several different ways to try and resolve this disjuncture. One way, the most radical, would be to suggest that if the concept of ornament is so muddled, It should perhaps be abandoned altogether and replaced by another more neutral term, such as detail, perhaps. Another approach of the wait and see kind would be to assume that the word ornament will, over time, regenerate itself, shedding its negative meanings, as Blumer proposes. And the third or middle way would be to disentangle the elements informing the concept of ornament, save those that are still relevant, and fashion a new definition of ornament. Ornament's problem, it turns out, is one both of definition and of history. Conceptually, from its inception, the meaning of ornament has been grounded in its relation to two other elements, structure and beauty. In the operative binary distinction between structure and ornament, ornament has been defined by what it is not. But neither is ornament linked to beauty, which instead floats somewhere above structure and ornament. Thus, the aesthetics of architecture has to grapple with where beauty resides, in the formal structure, in the ornament, in both. Historically, the problem is that the term ornament, as it is understood today, dates from the mid-19th century. Our concept of ornament as something added on to a pre-existing structure was codified in the 1850s and then froze, paving the way for the modernists' rejection of ornament. To quote the famous words of Adolphe Loos in his 1910 Ornament and Crime, quote, "The evolution of culture is synonymous with the removal of ornament from utilitarian objects. Therein lies the greatness of our age, that it is incapable of producing a new ornament. We have outgrown ornament. We have fought our way through to freedom from ornament." Though, as you see in Loos's Goldman and Salach building in Vienna, the concept of ornamentation is relative. For us, Loos's building is still ornament and is not quite outgrown it. At least in theory, if not in practice, this modernist rejection of ornament has left pure form or structure in a very awkward place. It has had to bear the dual charge of function and beauty, thus a beauty defined by function alone, making it almost impossible to talk about sensual, visual aspects of beauty. As Le Corbusier, whose Villa Savoye you see here, wrote in his 1923 Towards a New Architecture, quote, "If we eliminate from our hearts and minds all dead concepts in regard to the house and look at the question from a critical and an objective point of view, we shall arrive at the house machine, the mass production house, healthy and morally so too, and beautiful in the same way that working tools and instruments which accompany our existence are beautiful. The history of architecture unfolds itself slowly across the centuries as a modification of structure and ornament. But in the last 50 years, steel and concrete have brought new conquests, which are the index of a greater capacity for construction and of an architecture in which the old codes have been overturned. If we challenge the past, we shall learn that styles no longer exist for us, that a style belonging to our own period has come about, and there has been a revolution," end quote. And this new style was one supposedly shorn of ornament, honed like a tool to follow function and need. At the same time, as we saw above, 20th century practitioners have made and continue to make choices not dictated by purpose or function. Richard Meyer, for instance, known more for his clean rectilinear style, uses visual qualities such as the type of window frame and alternations of shapes to create surface ornamentation or plastic surface pattern across the surface. Others, like Norman Foster, have also chosen to highlight sensuous beauty in buildings using the surface quality of metal frame, reflection, refraction, sheen, and glass. Some have made functional elements into ornamental motifs, like Jean Nouvel at the Institut du Monde Arabe, where he uses camera shutters in the windows to keep out light that also double as Islamic decorative forms. Or even more explicitly, there are specific commissions for ornament, as in Francis Soler's exterior web-like covering to unite two different buildings of the Ministry of Culture and Communication in Paris. What should we call these? Are these decoration, sculpture, design element, personal expression, details? Thus the question is, how do we disentangle ornaments' relation to function, structure, and artistic beauty? Is there a way to reframe the relation among ornaments' defining elements and thus salvage the concept for contemporary architectural theory and practice? The following remarks are intended to help you along in this project, assuming that the answer is yes. First, by reminding you of ornaments' breadth of meanings, and second, by explaining why its development stopped in the 19th century. Perhaps these tools will enable you to pick up where the debates left off and help you to fashion new definitions suited to the buildings going up around us. To show you the varied nature of ornament, I would like to focus on four interesting moments in its history: the Roman classical, the Renaissance, the 18th century, and the 19th century. Like most stories about Western architecture, this one too begins with Vitruvius's 10 books of architecture, which you see here in Daniele Barbaro's 1567 edition, and with his reconstructed illustrations. Vitruvius's importance is dictated by happenstance rather than by merit. As the only surviving architectural treatise from the classical period, Vitruvius's 10 books became the touchstone for all and any discussions of classical architecture. But as the Renaissance architects were to discover, Vitruvius was a second-rate writer. He had no interest in offering architectural principles and enjoyed instead describing different types of buildings and features of classical architecture with relevant anecdotes. So when it came to ornament, Vitruvius, not surprisingly, does not offer a definition. Rather, the words ornamentum and ornatus, the first the noun, the second the adjective, convey a variety of meanings depending on their context in his treatise. At its broadest, ornament for Vitruvius is a synonym for decoration in general. Here is just one of many examples where Vitruvius uses ornament to refer to an entire wall as well as to specific decoration. Describing how one should decorate a stage, he explains, quote, "The parts of the scene are to be so distributed that the middle door may be decorated as one of a royal palace, those on the right and left as the doors of the guests. Near these are the spaces destined to receive the decorations. Each of these machines has three species of decoration, which, when the subject changes, or on the appearance of a god, are moved around with sudden claps of thunder and alter the appearance of the decoration." And whenever he uses the word decoration in the English, the Latin is ornatus or ornationis. And here I'm just showing you two images of a Roman theater in Guelma where such temporary and permanent decorations would have been put. As is clear, the term ornatus carries no distinctive meaning for Vitruvius. It is a generic term for both an entire area and or a particular detail. Vitruvius's other most common use of the word ornament links it specifically to the architectural orders, Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian. In this context, ornament refers to the various embellishments characterizing the three orders, both in relation to the column and the entablature. In the following passage, for instance, we see how ornament functions like womanly adornment to gender the different orders. Quote, "With a similar feeling, they," the ancient Greeks, "afterwards built the temple of Diana. They also added volutes to its capital like graceful curling hair hanging on each side, and the front they ornamented with cimetia and festoons in the place of hair. On the shafts, they sunk channels which bear a resemblance to the folds of matronal garment." Thus, two orders were invented, one of a masculine character without ornament, the other bearing a character which resembled the delicacy, ornament, and proportion of a female. The third species, which is called Corinthian, resembles in its character the graceful, elegant appearance of a virgin, in whom from her tender age the limbs are of a more delicate form and whose ornaments should be unobtrusive. Ornament here signals an entire facade of the temple as easily as individual details, of the columns shaft and capital. But when describing the three orders, Vitruvius differentiates their styles based on the quantity and type of ornament they carry, their general proportions, and their respective gendered nature. Thus, a temple dedicated to a goddess helped establish a new feminine order with higher columns and more embellishment, in contrast to the earlier masculine Doric style. In turn, the third order in this anthropomorphic tale is the most slender Corinthian, their virginal offspring. Ornament for the orders becomes like feminine embellishment, apparently there only to add adornment. In another section, however, Vitruvius claims that some architectural ornaments originally served a purpose. What we see in Roman buildings is only a marble reproduction of the originally wooden structural elements. Quote, "The origin and invention of the different species of columns having been discussed, it is now necessary to say something on the subject of their ornaments, how they originated, and upon what principles and for what purposes they were invented. Following the arrangement of timber framing, workmen have imitated, both in stone and marble, the disposition of timbers in sacred edifices. They then cut off the ends of the beams that projected over the external face of the wall, flush with its face. They fixed on the end of each beam so cut indented tablets, similar to the triglyphs now in use, and painted them with a waxen composition of a blue color, so that the ends of the beams in question might not be unpleasant to the eye. Thus, the ends of the timbers covered with tablets, indented as just mentioned, gave rise to the triglyph and metope in the Doric order." End quote. The marble decorations, according to Vitruvius, are slightly embellished structural details tied to a lost function. They are therefore not invented for visual adornment, but are the remnants of previous functional needs. And here I'm showing you Barbaro's attempt to reconstruct this Vitruvian passage in his illustrations. Vitruvius stresses the relation between ornament and function in another section as well. There he asserts that the best ornament must suit its intended purpose. Quote, "For the perfection of all works depends on their ornaments, fitness to answer the end proposed, and on principles resulting from a consideration of nature herself. And they, the original builders, approved those only which, by strict analogy, were borne out by the appearance of utility." End quote. We are here confronted with a typical example of Vitruvius's confusing writing. He retroactively justifies the role of ornament based on its original structural role. Yet classical ornament is only a visual reminder of wooden structures and no longer has one. So how can classical marble ornament achieve perfection if it no longer answers to an end? As you can see, Vitruvius provides no clear answers, but he does offer intriguing insights into ornament's multifold meanings. For one, Roman ornament refers to decoration as a whole as well as to individual parts. Second, ornament is sometimes seen as an additive element, covering or dressing a column or capital. But last of all, ornament also appears as a functional element, even if once removed. Reading Vitruvius, we are left wondering whether ornament is decoration or an elaborate detail, whether it is closer to something that encompasses all structural elements, or whether ornament is structure, in fact. Vitruvius's varied usage of the terms ornamentum and ornatus corresponds to that of his Roman contemporaries, with one important exception, treatises on rhetoric. Rhetoric, the art of writing and speaking, remained at the core of classical education, although lawyers and senators in imperial Rome could no longer use it to win political cases. Orators still competed in public debates, and their competitions focused on style. Style, elocutio, was that which embellished a discourse through the skillful display of ornament, figures of speech, such as similes, metaphors, alliteration, analogies, etc. In rhetoric, style, and thus ornament, verbally represented the abstract invention giving flesh to an idea. And as an art historian, I can't resist showing you some classical statues while I read the following passages. As I rather dramatically stated in the short description of this talk, one could even argue that the current limited meaning of architectural ornament comes from that of rhetoric. Perhaps I exaggerated a little. I did need a good hook for this lecture. But the art of rhetoric did offer the most precise interpretation of ornament as a defining element with its own rules and principles. And these writings on rhetoric, with their distinction between form and content, directly informed the later separation between ornament and structure in architecture. Quintilian, in his famous Institutes of Oratory, provides an excellent example of principles of ornament in rhetoric. Quote, "I come now to the subject of embellishment, ornatum, in which doubtless, more than in any other department of oratory, the speaker is apt to give play to his fancy. For when an audience finds it a pleasure to listen, their attention and their readiness to believe what they hear are both alike increased, while they are generally filled with delight and sometimes even transported by admiration. But let the embellishment, ornatus, of our style be manly, noble, and chaste. Let it not affect effeminate delicacy or a complexion counterfeited by paint, but let it glow with genuine health and vigor. So true is this, that although where ornament is concerned, vice and virtue are never far apart, those who employ a vicious style of embellishment disguise their vices with the name of virtue. Whatever, therefore, may be attractive in conception, elegant in expression, pleasing in figures, rich in metaphor, or polished in composition, the orator, like a dealer, as it were, in eloquence, will lay before his audience for them to inspect and almost to handle. But when a serious affair is in question, and there is a contest in real earnest, anxiety for mere applause should be an orator's last concern. I do not mean to say that no ornaments of dress should be bestowed on such subjects, but that they should be, as it were, more close-fitting and severe, and thus display themselves less, and they should be, above all, well adapted to their subject." Quintilian's lengthy passage is rich in advice for novice debaters. Ornament determines the style of the oration. The man in which an orator manipulates the richness of figurative language establishes his ability. Thus, he must vary his use of ornament according to the nature of the debate, more feminine for brilliant display and more manly for serious arguments. Following the tradition of rhetoric, Quintilian can neatly separate the content of the oration, the inventio, from its style of presentation, or elocutio. And elocutio is ornament. It is that which gives life and materiality to the abstract content of the oration. In rhetoric, there can be no confusion between form and content, as Quintilian makes extremely clear in another passage. Quote, "Every speech consists at once of that which is expressed and of that which expresses, that is, of matter and words," end quote. Thus, ornament is the verbal form that gives life to the matter. And the best orator then adapts the words to the matter as well as to its purpose. As Quintilian explains, "Shall I regard a farm as a model of good cultivation because its owner shows me lilies and violets and anemones and fountains of living water, in place of which crops and vines bowed beneath their clusters? No, let such luxuries delight the rich. A horse whose flanks are compact is not only better to look upon, but swifter in speed. The athlete whose muscles have been formed by exercise is a joy to the eye, but he is also better fitted for the contests in which he must engage. In fact, true beauty and usefulness always go hand in hand. It is important to note that such seemly ornament, ornatus, must be varied to suit the nature of the material to which it is applied. True beauty thus arises from the perfect fit between the visual form of an athlete, horse, or garden, say, and their respective roles as contestant, racehorse, or productive farm. The orator must adapt his figurative language to the type of oration he writes. And I'm showing you here examples of ideal proportions of an athlete and also of Leonardo's reconstruction of Vitruvius's ideal man. Quintilian's illuminating passages on ornament complete those of Vitruvius. For both, ornament and beauty are indistinguishable, the one blending into the other. Both associate ornament with external, often feminine dress, covering an inner content or structure. For both, ornament embellishes by creating a specific style, be it rhetorical or architectural. And finally, both state that the highest form of beauty in ornament is that which best answers to its intended end. But while Vitruvius is not able to clarify ornament's purpose in architecture, Quintilian can do so in rhetoric. The orator matches his verbal form or ornament to his chosen content. Thus, verbal form or ornament is separate from content, expressing its intended purpose. When Renaissance intellectuals turned to such Latin sources over 1,000 years later, they were searching for specific principles to help them revive the lost golden age of antiquity. But for their search, they first had to understand surviving Latin texts, many of whose words they no longer understood. They therefore used all resources available to them, studying, measuring, and classifying Roman ruins, while they excavated the key syntactical terms of classical authors. It is only within this context that one can appreciate Leon Battista Alberti's efforts to interpret Vitruvius's treatise. Both an architect and a humanist, Alberti soon realized that Vitruvius's 10 books on architecture did not provide the set of architectural principles he was looking for. And so Alberti decided to write his own architectural treatise, De Re Edificatoria, which would represent a distilled and comprehensible version of Vitruvius's. The result was the creation of a new Renaissance idiom for both the theory and practice of architecture. Alberti's most influential transformation of Vitruvius occurs in his treatment of ornament. Given the lack of a definition in Vitruvius's text, Alberti had to establish his own. His approach was first to separate beauty from ornament in architecture, a separation that did not formally exist, and next, to determine their relation to each other. Quote, "The precise nature of beauty and ornament and the difference between them, the mind could perhaps visualize more clearly than my words could explain. For the sake of brevity, however, let us define them as follows. Beauty is that reasoned harmony of all the parts within a body, so that nothing may be added, taken away, or altered, but for the worse. If this is conceded, ornament may be defined as a form of auxiliary light and complement to beauty. From this it follows, I believe, that beauty is some inherent property to be found suffused all through the body of that which may be called beautiful, whereas ornament, rather than being inherent, has the character of something attached or additional." In these few sentences, Alberti influenced the fate of ornament over the next 500 years. His solution was to make a clean cut between beauty and ornament. He placed beauty on one side as a perfection suited to structure, and ornament on the other as an extraneous embellishment. While beauty became an element intrinsic to the original form, ornament became an appendage, added on to enhance beauty's original perfection. The brilliance of these axioms was their simplicity, achieved by defining and separating two terms. The problem was that they enclosed a paradox. How can perfection be added to? What is beauty of form if ornament is the enhancer of its beauty? Alberti arrived at his quixotic axiom by distilling ideas culled from classical sources and recombining them into new principles. He wished to delineate the relation between beauty and ornament. Thus, from Vitruvius and other Latin texts, he knew ornament to be adornment or embellishment layered on to an interior form, as in clothing or the column. He also knew it to signal the style of architecture or rhetoric. Hence, beauty remained within the original body of form, while ornament lived in the embellishing dress added to the form. And I'm showing you Alberti's Tempio Malatestiano in Rimini, with a whole clad in marble Revetment, which is Alberti's reinterpretation of the classical form, creating the new Renaissance idiom. But it is from the art of rhetoric that Alberti would have truly understood ornament to be an external, material manifestation of the orator's original idea or invention. Applying this idea to architecture, Alberti envisioned ornament and architecture as the outward expression of the original structure or invention. Just as in rhetoric, ornament now enhances and expresses through its style the inner purpose or content of the building. Perhaps Alberti assumed that just as ideas could not exist without words, so too a building's original structure could not exist without expressive style or ornament. By attaching beauty both to the perfected structure as well as to ornament, Alberti demonstrated that both were necessary for true beauty. But of course, the modernists were to try and prove him wrong. Alberti's principles of architecture fueled the practice and theory of architecture over the next few centuries. They remained unchallenged until the 18th century, when the development of the Rococo exposed unintended interpretations of Alberti's famous definition. If ornament only expressed embellishment, then it could also become the privileged site of unadulterated visual pleasure. It is ornament's paradoxical freedom from function that allowed it in the 18th century to challenge the very premises of its Albertian existence. The Rococo style enabled ornamental practice to blossom with an unprecedented level of creativity. 18th century ornament challenged the frame, structures, even the materials it was supposed to enhance. Subversion of ornament's traditional subordination became the norm, as designers invented an artistic language that celebrated the pure movement of abstract form. Turning Alberti's principle on its head, artists moved ornament out of its auxiliary position dependent on the central form onto center stage. There it dominates the original form, function, and content of the original structure. While you are probably familiar with some of the excesses of Rococo style, you might not be so familiar with its theorists. One in particular, Carl Philipp Moritz, recognized the aesthetic implications of abstract ornament. He began to develop his thoughts in an unfinished work called Prolegomena to a Theory of Ornament. The surviving fragments offer a radically new interpretation of ornament, as the following passages make clear. Quote, "The frame adorns a painting because it isolates it, sets it apart from the surrounding mass of other objects, and commends it to our attention as an exceptional object. All settings adorn by containing and isolating the thing they set apart, by detaching it from the surrounding mass of objects, and by presenting it as something exceptionally worthy of our attention. The vase, the container par excellence, is thus an ornament in itself because it embodies the idea of the thing that isolates and contains within itself. The form of the vase emerges of its own accord from the natural idea of containing. A thing that is to contain will open and widen gradually, for if it were as wide below as it is above, it would appear to be passive rather than active. It would not stand for the living idea of containment. If the vase's character is that of conserving, the form must contract still farther up beneath its rim, which represents its completion. If it is made for dipping, it must slightly retreat into itself beneath its rim. If it is of the offering kind, its wider rim needs not give away to a contraction," end quote. Here Moritz defines ornament as that which isolates, presents, or sets apart the thing it surrounds, which the vase exceptionally embodies in its totality. In this case, ornament has become an intrinsic part of the object or structure, simultaneously expressing its purpose and beauty. It might be only in the vase that Moritz's definition of ornament coincides with the idea of the object. Yet, as he develops this idea, one sees that the specific details of the vase's forms must in turn correspond to their differing functions, pouring as opposed to conserving or dipping. And this opens up the possibility that other types of objects and structures could embody their purpose and so too become ornament. In fact, this way of thinking does seem to underpin Moritz's brief discussion of architecture. In his criticism of Borromini's buildings, Moritz declares that form as ornament must visually and literally express the structure's function, which he feels Borromini's churches do not do. Quote, curves and bends are not beautiful in a building because they are not in keeping with the concept of a building in which the entablature resting on columns lies in a straight line. Curved lines in architecture offend not so much the eye as the intellect. The undulating line is not beautiful in itself, but by virtue of the idea of motion that is associated with it. In a ship, on the other hand, the curved line is beautiful because it harmonizes with the idea of mobility. In chairs and tables, in which the idea of stability is dominant, undulating lines are therefore always inappropriate. For Moritz, architecture and furniture must embody stability, following their own rectilinear structure. Thus, although Moritz does not precisely state this, it follows that if the form of a building conveys the idea of stability, its inner concept, then its entire form, like that of a vase, is also an ornament. Despite Moritz's condemnation of Borromini and his curving architectural lines, which we saw in San Carlo and St. Ivo, one wonders whether he would have approved of architecture that had no structural need of columns and entablatures. Since he condemns curves solely on structural grounds, perhaps he would have accepted them as long as the concept of stability emerged in some other way. What would he have thought of Gehry's Guggenheim interior, for instance, which retains Borromini's undulating, soaring forms without the column, entablature, skeleton? Certainly, Moritz values ornament in and of itself. In another passage, he extols its role as a visible sign of human creativity. As such, it demands our aesthetic appreciation wherever it appears. Describing Raphael's loggias in the Vatican Palace, Moritz writes, quote, "The urge to decorate is therefore a noble drive of the human soul, one that distinguishes man from the beast, which only satisfies its needs. And if this drive is not led astray, it is just as beneficial to man as is his drive for knowledge and high art. The true strength of the instinct for beauty appears in this. Even where beauty no longer finds a place, humans seek at least to find a place for ornament." For Moritz, Raphael's arabesques and grotesques demonstrate that ornament, like the high or fine arts, is a pure expression of our need for beauty. It is something we as humans cannot do without. One wonders where ornament would be today if Moritz's aesthetic theories had been pursued, redefining ornament as the articulation of inner purpose. Prized as the manifestation of creative drive, ornament could have emerged as the material embodiment of a building's concept. As such, ornament would have been organically and conceptually fused with structure, both replete with creative beauty. But with the advent of machine production, architectural ornament was caught up in the crisis of its promiscuous proliferation. 19th century debates about ornament bypassed 18th century theories such as Moritz's and took up Alberti's original principle for their own ends. And in their hands, this principle distinguished all too clearly between structure and ornament. Ornament's critics thus asserted ornament to be a superfluous indicator of revivalist styles. Its defenders argued that ornament added visual pleasure and beauty, while accepting nonetheless the binary distinction of structure and ornament. These last defenders even embraced ornament's independence as proof of its own artistic status. Intentionally or not, both sides ended up further diminishing ornament's stature. From Vitruvius's and Alberti's vision of ornament as a three-dimensional architectonic element, ornament now became a linear, two-dimensional fragment or motif. Two prominent defenders of ornament, the designer Owen Jones and the art historian Alois Riegel best exemplify this development. Both men vehemently believed in ornament as a distinct art form, endowing it with artistic and historical principles. Yet, in privileging its independence, their writings and images stripped ornament of its three-dimensional physicality, severing its ties to a material support or ornament carrier. Owen Jones' Grammar of Ornament, published in 1856, of which you see the title page, was the first compilation of ornamental design to cover such an encyclopedic range, from Savage to Egyptian, classical, Islamic, Chinese, and European ornament. The aim of the grammar, as Jones explained in his preface, was to improve current artistic practice. To this end, Jones offered his readers 37 simple principles of design, which the beautiful illustrations were supposed to complement. The problem, of course, was that the visual force of these images completely dominated the principles, while they also fashioned a new type of ornament presentation based on fragments and motifs. Jones uses two types of images throughout. The first consists of black and white illustrations, while the second exhibits colorful geometric forms laid out in full-page compositions. In the black and white illustrations, entire Maori implements are visible, but depicted out of context with little recognition of texture or material. In the colored plates, this strategy is taken to an extreme. The plate of so-called Savage Tribe ornament on the right shows small, flat, colorful rectangles, which are actually details of clothing made from bark and stamped with geometric designs. Each small rectangle offers a fragment of a recurring pattern, or what we call motif. Jones heightens this artistic isolation of the motif by eliminating all contextual references. Here, for instance, Jones composes a Renaissance cupola decoration by freely assembling ornamental fragments culled from different sources to produce an overall centralized composition. Thus, Jones's representational technique eliminates ornament's original texture and medium. These ornaments become self-sufficient fragments, independent of the object, material, or support they originally came from, making them universally applicable. Let us now turn to Jones's ambitious principles, which free ornamental design from all external considerations. Jones begins by stressing ornament's dependence on architecture. He then explains in Proposition 4, which is there, you can't really read it, but, quote, "True beauty results from that repose which the mind feels when the eye, the intellect, and the affections are satisfied from the absence of any want. Beauty of form," he continues in Proposition 6, "is produced by lines growing out from one another. Nothing could be removed and leave the design equally good or better." In a clever reversal, Jones has taken Alberti's famous definition of beauty in architecture and applied it to ornament itself. Jones endows ornament with beauty as a separate art form and creates principles that enable it to achieve beauty of form through composition, shading, style, and color. By the end, ornament has acquired a set of artistic rules similar to those of the fine arts. Jones's illustrations and commentary together endow ornament with universal principles of beauty that can be applied regardless of material purpose and technique. But by liberating design from practical requirements, Jones worsened ornament's position. He was already worried that his illustrations would increase the eclecticism of contemporary ornamental practice. "It is more than probable," he comments in his preface, "that the first result of sending forth to the world this collection will be seriously to increase this dangerous tendency of historical eclecticism, and that many will be content to borrow from the past those forms of beauty which have already been used up ad nauseam," end quote. And Jones was right. His beautiful pages flooded the market with ready-made patterns for the eager designers, and most were published without his principles even being attached. But what he could not predict was that his intended liberation of ornament would only serve to confirm its status as a superfluous element. Given the world of Victorian elaborate machine-made decorations, ornaments simply could not assert its claim to artistic value, even though possessed of both beauty and artistic principles in Jones's grammar. Without materiality, ornament was an idea devoid of true form, prey to exploitation for all and any uses. Alois Riegel, founder of the Viennese School of Art History, recognized the theoretical possibilities raised in Jones's grammar of ornament. As a historian of textiles and defender of decorative arts, his aim was to establish a continuous history of ornament from the Egyptian to the Roman and later Islamic periods. But to write such a history, which he did in his 1893 Stilfragen, or Questions of Style, Riegel had to establish ornament's independent evolution as an art form, one separate from that of its material support in architecture or the decorative arts. At the same time, Riegel posited his own theoretical principles of ornament's independent evolution, supported by an analysis of individual motifs as they slowly metamorphose into each other. Thus, like Jones and Moritz before him, Riegel treated ornament as the product of a human urge for beauty and as a carrier of style. But he could only do so at great cost by focusing on fragments of decoration and ornament, divorced from their original contextual role and thus from any expressive content. Riegel's illustrations make this point very clearly. His line drawings reduce ornament to the outline of one motif, here the lotus, with its parts individually labeled. The minute transformations of these elements allow him to track this motif's stylistic development as it slowly mutates over several centuries, becoming the Greek palmette, similar to Jones. And in fact, Riegel reproduces the central part of Jones's illustration in his own work, but in black and white. In his line drawings, Riegel eliminates color as well as three-dimensional form. And like Jones, Riegel rarely reproduces an entire object. But in his zeal, Riegel's visual analyses reduce ornament even more than had Jones's illustrations. Ornament becomes a disembodied outline detail of, in the end, repetitive, mechanical, and dead forms. And we can see in Frank Meyer's Handbook of Ornament one of many examples of similar pattern books based simply on the repetition of motifs. As had Moritz, Riegel and Jones believed that ornament, like all art, arose from the human desire to create. As Jones put it in his defense of ornament, quote, "What we seek in every work of art, whether it be humble or pretentious, is the evidence of mind, the evidence of that desire to create," end quote. But unlike Moritz, Riegel and Jones aspired for ornament to be something that it could not achieve, the equal of the fine arts of painting, architecture, and sculpture. With them, the theory of ornament outstripped the possibilities of its 19th century practice, especially since that practice had made ornament a ubiquitous addition to buildings, utensils, and even machines. Thus, ornament was condemned in practice and theory when it was conceptually at its weakest. And then, given the consensus about ornament's demise, writers, architects, and critics simply stopped debating about its nature and artistic value. We have therefore inherited a freeze-dried notion of ornament preserved intact from the 19th century, in which ornament survives as a mere contour, infinitely repetitive and infinitely applicable to any and all surfaces. And though frozen in time, this concept of ornament flourishes today, even in some cases informing current practice, as in postmodernism's playful invocation of individual ornamental motifs. But if we wish for the concept of ornament to correspond to architectural practice beyond postmodernists' tongue-in-cheek reference, it is high time to take on the difficult task of developing a new theory of ornament. I hope that this talk has helped you in this project. First, by contextualizing the current definition of ornament, and second, by showing you earlier alternative ways of thinking about ornament. As we have seen in the writings of Vitruvius and Moritz, ornament need not be conceptually severed from form. the structural ornament dichotomy erupted because of the crisis of 19th century ornament. It is not what Alberti would have intended or even understood when he posited ornament as an extra form of beauty. He himself was simply applying to architecture a way of looking at ornament borrowed from the art of rhetoric, a helpful distinction between form and content, but one woefully distorted five centuries later. As we see in contemporary practice, ornament is anything but separate from structure. Even if not by name, it is embedded both in artistic details and overall structure of current architectural fabric. For instance, the Laboratory for Visionary Architecture, LAVA's designers, in their model for the Schumacher corporate building in Abu Dhabi, posit the source of their building's geometric design in the snowflake, to which is then applied aerodynamics principles of Formula One. The result, they explain, is an iconic image that is a corporate brand reproducible in seven other buildings planned throughout the world. And this recognizable branding emerges from LAVA's technological merging of ornamental design in detail, structure, and exterior skin. The modernists successfully rid architecture of bad Victorian decoration by wielding a reductivist definition of ornament. It is now time for us to rid ornament of their reductivist interpretation. Nonetheless, we should also beware of falling into the opposite extreme of exalting ornament as a fourth and separate form of artistic endeavor. As we have seen, that too can diminish and limit ornament's full potential. Ornament is an innate and intrinsic part of buildings and objects, but literally cannot stand on its own. For ornament's true expressive force emerges from its fusion of creativity and form, a visual and technical problem solving, to borrow Gombrich's vision of artistic progress. In all the texts I've cited and the images I've shown, ornament, even if undeclared, emerges as an element of beauty, joy, play, and creative impulse. But to preserve this term with its rich associations, you must reclaim it as your own, articulating a new theory that does justice to this ever-changing but permanent auxiliary light of architecture. Thank you. Frank Lloyd Wright, though he talks about machine production and he has these great manifestos, in practice, he's actually creating a complete interior design. Which I think we would reinterpret as an ornamental whole. So I think the disjunction between theory and practice is always going to be there as well, and I really am only focusing on the theory of the ideal of what they're saying.
How come Alberti bypassed all the centuries in between classicism and the Renaissance? Were there no theories there to look back to or pick up on?
No. And they considered the Middle Ages is called the Middle Ages because of the Renaissance. The 15th century humanists had nothing but contempt for the sort of bad Latin and poor text that survived. So it really was an archaeological expedition of finding old texts from the Roman period. And there was nothing. I mean, there were some Gothic theories of building, but it wasn't the same. It didn't actually present whole texts. And the Renaissance was consciously trying to skip over that medieval period, seeing it only as something to be shunned and to move away from. Mm-hmm. Got it.
Hello. I've enjoyed your argument, but it's an extremely Eurocentric one.
Oh, absolutely.
And I had wondered if you could speak to extending your argument, for example, in the so-called Dark Ages of Europe, was more or less the flourishing of the Chinese system. Mm-hmm. We had their own theories of ornament, or in Mesoamerica, mm-hmm. where ornament is not separate from structure.
No, you're absolutely right, and I should have had a disclaimer that I really am just presenting the European Western theory of ornament, which I know is not the only one influencing contemporary practice, but I really only know that one. So what I'm presenting has to be seen within that tradition.
But isn't it true that early modernism or the kind of late 18th and early 19th century start to be heavily influenced by...
They took the motifs. They didn't take the theory.
Didn't take the theory.
No. So, something which we find today, if you open up a book on ornament, guided by what are also completely Europeanized labels of chinoiserie, arabesque, moresques, and all of these are completely artificial names pulled in the 18th and 19th century. And that's when all of these, the ornament was and then just classified as a way fueling the revivalist styles of the late 19th century.
And did you ever have an interest in the history of jewelry? Anthropologists argue that ornament starts as the first human artifacts.
Oh, well, the debates about the first ornament and when it starts and whether it starts as Regal had thought also is the first year.
Anthropologists normally argue that's to do with identity mm-hmm. rather than either form or beauty.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that it says. I mean, I'm sure this is so. I will confirm or agree or believe that obviously ornament has been with us throughout time and is clearly, like Moritz says, it is an instinct of human behavior. In the back.
I was interested when you're talking about Alberti's theory mm-hmm. on ornament as a kind of a rhetoric. And I was wondering, maybe I'm getting confused, or I was wondering if you could help me to define what's the difference between, or how would you define ornament with style or architectural language?
That's the whole challenge, isn't it? That,
yeah.
that I don't think we can define these terms. I don't think we can pinpoint them. What I was trying to show is that ornament is a very fluid term. And I think the problem is in its being circumscribed and defined in this very, very narrow way by the modernists, so that they could then sort of condemn the 19th century historical styles. We're caught up in this. I mean, I do say we should redefine it, but I don't mean to give an exact definition. Ornament is, you know, fill in the dots. But I think conceptually we can think about what ornament is by saying it's both architectural detail as well as decoration or style, but it's a real challenge. Style has been a word that can be very negative because of the 19th century connotations. So when you put ornament and style together, what it evokes immediately are the ghosts of all of the revivalist styles, because ornament by itself, if you had a little palmette, that meant you were doing a classical style. If you had some kind of Egyptian motif, you were doing Egyptian revivalist style. But I think that's exactly the challenge, and especially for contemporary architects, as you are doing your own work, to think about what it is, where it is coming from, so that you can try to put into words the new idea of what ornament is in your own work. And I think only by trying to articulate it in these different ways we'll be able to get out from fighting this sort of rear-end battle against this old definition.
Surely what has happened now is the whole building is all
right. It is, absolutely.
Bob Maxwell said that of
Sterling's work. Mm-hmm. Yeah, or Gary's. Yes, but then I would say, well, maybe it's not an ornament, maybe it's also just an objet d'art, and there we get into the whole decorative art discussion. What's the difference between then high art? Why isn't it a sculpture as opposed to being an ornament? So all of these terms are very, very slippery. And
but the distinction between structure uh-huh. and what is applied to the structure has vanished.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's now an ornament with bathrooms.
Or it's a structure with no ornament, depending on how you define ornament. It's precisely that. It depends what you're bringing, what definition you're carrying to what you see. But yes, that's the whole challenge. Yes.
Does anybody then persist with Moritz's definition?
Unfortunately, no. 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 I was so happy to discover his writings.
Well, they persist in Las Vegas with it. They build buildings and ornament them. And they have specialists called, what are they called? Can't remember now. Anyway, they do have specialists. I mean, Disney and Vegas are the only people who actually have specialists in ornament. Mm-hmm. They're not architects. Architects are project managers in Vegas. They've been demoted.
They're finished. So maybe the future is we'll all be designers, which is the term, actually, that is now used. So decorative art is no longer called decorative art. It's called design. It's even affecting the American names coming from Britain. And the design implies that what you start with is a two-dimensional form without materiality as well.
Okay, good. There are no more questions. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You. Right, though he talks about machine production and he has these great manifestos, in practice, he's actually creating a complete interior design, which I think we would reinterpret as an ornamental whole. So I think the disjuncture between theory and practice is always going to be there as well, and I'm really only focusing on the theory of the ideal of what they're saying.
How come Alberti bypassed all the centuries in between classicism and the Renaissance? Were there no theories there to look
no.
back to or pick up on?
No. And they considered the Middle Ages is called the Middle Ages because of the Renaissance. The 15th century humanists had nothing but contempt for the sort of bad Latin and poor texts that survived. So it really was an archaeological expedition. Finding old texts from the Roman period, and there was nothing. I mean, there were some Gothic theories of building, but it wasn't the same. It didn't actually present whole texts. And the Renaissance was consciously trying to skip over that medieval period, seeing it only as something to be shunned and to move away from. Mm-hmm.
I've enjoyed your argument, but it's an extremely Eurocentric one.
Oh, absolutely.
And
I'm
had wondered if you had could speak to extending your argument, for example, in the so-called Dark Ages of Europe, was more or less the flourishing of the Chinese system. Mm-hmm. We had their own theories of ornament, or in Mesoamerica, mm-hmm. where ornament is not separate from structure.
No, you're absolutely right, and I should have had a disclaimer that I really am just presenting the European Western theory of ornament, which I know is not the only one influencing contemporary practice, but I really only know that one. So what I'm presenting has to be seen within that tradition.
But isn't it true that early modernism or the kind of late 18th and early 19th century start to be heavily influenced by...
They took the motifs. They didn't take the theory.
Didn't take the theory.
No. So, I mean, something which we find today, if you open up a book on ornament, divided by what are also completely Europeanized labels of chinoiserie, arabesques, mauresques, and all of these are completely artificial names pulled in the 18th and 19th century. And that's when all of these, the ornament was and then just classified as a way fueling the revivalist styles of the late 19th century.
And did you ever have an interest in the history of jewelry? Anthropologists argue that ornament starts as the first human artifact.
Oh, well, the debates about the first ornament. and when it starts, and whether it starts as Riegel had thought also is the first year.
Anthropologists normally argue that's to do with identity mm-hmm. rather than either form or beauty.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that it's. I mean, I'm sure this is so. I will confirm or agree or believe that obviously ornament has been with us throughout time and is clearly, like Moritz says, it is an instinct of human behavior. In the back.
I was interested when you're talking about Alberti's theory mm-hmm. on ornament as a kind of a rhetoric. And I was wondering, maybe I'm getting confused, or I was wondering if you could help me to define what's the difference between, or how would you define ornament with style or architectural language?
That's the whole challenge, isn't it?
Yeah.
That I don't think we can define these terms. I don't think we can pinpoint them. What I was trying to show is that ornament is a very fluid term, and I think the problem is in its being circumscribed and defined in this very, very narrow way by the modernists, so that they could then sort of condemn the 19th century historical styles. We're caught up in this. I mean, I do say we should redefine it, but I don't mean to give an exact definition. Ornament is, fill in the dots. But I think conceptually we can think about what ornament is by saying it's both architectural detail as well as decoration or style, but it's a real challenge. Style has been a word that can be very negative because of the 19th century connotations. So when you put ornament and style together, what it evokes immediately are the ghosts of all of the revivalist styles, because ornament by itself, if you had a little palmette, that meant you were doing a classical style. If you had some kind of Egyptian motif, you were doing Egyptian revivalist style. But I think that's exactly the challenge, and especially for contemporary architects, as you are doing your own work, to think about what it is, where it is coming from, so that you can try to put into words the new idea of what ornament is in your own work. And I think only by trying to articulate it in these different ways we'll be able to get out from fighting this sort of rear-end battle against this old definition.
Surely what has happened now is the whole building is an
ornament. It is, absolutely.
Paul Maxwell said that of Sterling's work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or Gary's. Yes, but then I would say, well, maybe it's not an ornament, maybe it's also just an objet d'art, and there we get into the whole decorative art discussion. What's the difference between then high art? Why isn't it a sculpture as opposed to being an ornament? So all of these terms are very, very slippery. And
But the distinction between structure uh-huh. and what is applied to the structure has vanished.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's now an ornament with bathrooms.
Or it's a structure with no ornament, depending on how you define ornament. It's precisely that. It depends what you're bringing, what definition you're carrying to what you see. But yes, that's the whole challenge. Yes.
Does anybody then persist with Moritz's definition?
Unfortunately, no. No. No, I was so happy to discover his writings.
Well, they persist in Las Vegas with it. They build buildings and ornament them. And they have specialists called, what are they called? Can't remember now. Anyway, they do have specialists. I mean, Disney and Vegas are the only people who actually have specialists in ornament. Mm-hmm. They're not architects. Architects are project managers in Vegas. They've been demoted.
They're finished. So maybe the future is we'll all be designers, which is the term actually that is now used. So decorative art is no longer called decorative art, it's called design. It's even affecting the American names coming from Britain. And the design implies that what you start with is a two-dimensional form without materiality as well. Good.
No more questions. Thank you very
much. Thank you.